Well-known evolutionary geneticist Theodosia Dobzhansky famously wrote, quote, "Nothing in biology makes sense except in the light of evolution," end quote. Yet it is often also stated that evolution is only a theory, not a fact. How can these statements be reconciled, or should they? And also, how do scientists view the validity of evolution and the meaning of the words theory and fact? Larry?
Thanks, Rich. That's a great question. And I get that in my classes all the time. Anybody here from Cobb County, Georgia? Raise your hand. Do we have anybody in my classes? I usually have, yeah, there's one right there. Right, and so this issue came to light for me when Cobb County, Georgia, the Board of Education required that the biology textbooks have a sticker in the front of them that basically said that this book covers the theory of evolution, right? And that the theory of evolution is just a theory and not a fact. And therefore, you should read it critically and weigh the evidence and that sort of thing. And the reason that that jumps out at me is because evolution is both a theory and a fact, right? Regardless of what the Cobb County Board of Education thought at the time. And so this answer sort of requires you thinking about the way scientists treat the term theory and fact when they talk about it. And so just on the back of a napkin right now, you get out a pencil, and I could say three terms, and I could ask you to rank them in the terms of relative importance to a scientist. Like I could say, how important is the word theory? How important is the word fact? How important is the word hypothesis in terms of supporting a general idea in science? You could do that exercise right now. And you would probably say, well, facts are the most important thing, right? And theories, you know, theories like when my roommate comes home and he's got his collar all pulled up and his shirt's untucked, he's got lipstick, right? I got a theory about what happened. It could be shady, right? Not a whole bunch of evidence to support it. That's not the way scientists think about this term, right? In fact, facts are just facts to scientists, right? They're easy to come by. You just go out and make some observations. Those are facts. They don't explain anything. But the way scientists use the term theory is that a theory has to account for all of the facts that we find, has to account for all of the observations that we make in biology. And so, in a sense, the theory of evolution is a theory in that it accounts for all of the observations that we observe in the living world, okay? So it's a theory that way. But evolution is also a fact in that we can observe facts of evolution, right? So in a sense, you could look at all of the cars out in the parking lot. You could find really old ones, right? You could find really new ones. And you could observe, right, as a demonstrable fact that these cars have changed, right? The automobile has changed over time in terms of gas mileage and the way it looks and how fast it goes and how safe they are, right? That's evolution, non-cyclical change over time. Okay? So the evolution of the automobile is a demonstrable fact in that, right? And we can do this with geology, right? Geology, demonstrable fact, geological evolution takes place. English language, demonstrable fact, right? Like reading Chaucer, kind of hard, harder than Shakespeare. But you can see how the English language has changed over time. That's a demonstrable fact. We can do the same thing with biology, or we can dig up fossils. We can look at the fossil history of organisms on this planet. We can demonstrate how they have changed in a non-cyclical fashion over time, right? So in that sense, evolution is a fact, but evolution is also a theory, right? In the way that it explains all of our observations. So that's how I would answer that question, Rich, if that were posed.
Anyone on the panel want to add anything to what Dr. Adams said? Okay, we'll go to the next question, and thank you. This is for Dr. Dwayne Jeffrey. Dr. Jeffrey is a professor emeritus of biology, actually zoology, really, from BYU. He received a doctorate in genetics at University of California, Berkeley. He's done a lot of work. He's probably the expert on science and religion, given the local situation of science and religion. He knows this field extensively. And for Dr. Jeffrey's question, there are essentially, one thing I should mention, if you don't take the Daily Herald, you ought to be able to make arrangements to get it just on Wednesdays to read Dr. Jeffrey's column on science and religion. It's great. There are essentially two movements in opposition to or to evolution education. One is called creationism, or creation science, and the other intelligent design. What's the difference between them, and does either have a solid scientific basis? And we also hear, why don't we emphasize critical thinking in our schools? Let the students hear both sides of this argument and make up their own minds.
Jeffrey.
The history, I think, of this is rather critical. That is that religion in general, Christian world in particular, was just focused for that for now, has long had difficulty with the growth of science. Science grew out of Christianity, and yet many people were having difficulty reconciling themselves to the child that they had, to which they had given birth. There was the feeling, particularly, you know, we went through the Copernicus era, and you know, does the Earth go around the Sun, and all this sort of thing. Bible's pretty clear: is the Earth spherical or is it flat? Bible's pretty clear. But we found that we could, you know, where there were ways to live with that sort of view. With Darwin, it was, you know, that gets home. That gets right to us, and so there was some concern there. People began to feel that the world was going to hell in a handbasket, that students didn't have the morals they used to have. I don't know if students have ever had morals, but you know, but it was good to be able to blame it on something. And so, beginning back in the early part of the 19th century, of the 20th century, excuse me, we began to see a revulsion against science, against evolution in particular, that came really from evangelical Christianity. And by the 1920s, that led up to the famous Scopes trial and so on. 8 of the southern states had passed laws that it was illegal to teach anything for the origin of humans other than what was in the Bible. And the Scopes trial got into the fact that nobody can really figure out what the Bible says. But however that went, it needed a scientific rationale. And so there were people then who invented what was known as creation science, claiming that there's some real science to teach the creationism view of things that they were getting from their literal reading of the Bible. It was very clear that it was not the science that drove them to that position. They merely were trying to find something in science they could use to justify the position. Basic ideas of creation science are that there is a sovereign God, a God who controls everything, who is the only necessary being in the universe, the only necessary being that he cannot not exist. Everything else is dependent totally on his will. He spoke everything else into existence, and he can speak it out. That's the sovereign deity. Earth is about 6 to 10,000 years old. Everything was spoken into existence in about six little 24-hour days. That's the kind of thing. Now, for Mormon students who may be here, those ideas were thrown out by Mormonism in its first decade. But however that may be, they started pushing for equal time in the classroom. That ultimately came to a major trial from Judge William Overton, and it became very clear from the creationist witnesses on the stand that they really didn't have solid scientific reasons for pushing their points of view. It's purely something to validate a religious point of view. So shortly after that, intelligent design was developed. Since it had been argued with the creationists that you are trying to put religion into the classroom, and that's a no-no. Intelligent design said we can get around that. We can use many of the same arguments, but we will not identify the designer. We will argue that there are things that are irreducibly complex, so complex that we can't see how any natural law could be done. And it couldn't be chance, therefore it had to be a designer. But what's the designer's name? We don't know. If we were to give him a name, that would make it religion. And so that has been their attack, their approach. They have argued also for inclusion in the classroom. We had a panel here and, you know, just upstairs or in the other building a couple, 3 years ago with some of their people who admitted we don't have a scientific basis and we cannot design experiments because it all depends on how the designer happened to want to do something. And since we don't really know what he wants to do, we can't design experiments. Well, in that case, you can't do science. And so that went to trial in Dover, Pennsylvania, 4, 5, 6 years ago. And once again, the witnesses came in and were literally torn apart by the legal team because they couldn't demonstrate they were science at all. For those who would like to pursue it, there are some books. 40 Days and 40 Nights is a good one. Monkey Girl is another good one that reviews the trial. for intelligent design in a classroom, probably the best one is Eugenie Scott's book, Not in Our Classrooms. But neither intelligent design nor creationism has any scientific basis that would validate that in the classroom. And so that's where the issue has to stay. It's a manufactured controversy. That was a tactic they borrowed from the tobacco industry. If we can demonstrate that there's a controversy out there, or make it look like one, that the science is not settled, detectability. We're seeing that today, absolutely, with climate change deniers as well. Let's let it go from here.
You don't want to add anything?
Jerry.
I think one of the really interesting ideas that comes out of intelligent design is, so you sort of ask them, what's the premise of the movement? What's the sort of core idea? And one of the ideas is really quite an old idea, that some biological phenomena are just simply too complex to be explained by natural processes. So they term this irreducible complexity. And the argument is that if we find something that's so complex that we can't conceive a natural explanation, or we haven't demonstrated the mechanism by which a complex trait comes about, then they choose to attribute that to an intelligent designer. Right? So that's something that sort of falls beyond the pale of science, because we don't have an answer for how it could have come about yet. It's interesting that's sort of the default position. Something that's complex must be created by a designer of some sort. And what's interesting about how science operates is that these sorts of problems are the very kinds of things that we love to work on. Right? We ask, how could something complex come about? And so, whereas something like intelligent design says, look, if it's too hard to explain, we'll attribute that to be evidence for an intelligent designer. In science, we sort of take that as a challenge to say, is there a mechanism? How can we sort of figure out how this might work? And intelligent design has some specific examples they've offered up, things like the complexity of the bacterial flagellum or biochemical pathways, for example. And it's interesting, what's happened is that as those ideas have come about, scientists have got to work on them and have looked at how incremental changes can lead to this kind of complexity. One of the interesting things about the philosophy of intelligent design is that it sort of leaves the creator or the designer in these gaps where our knowledge is weak. We can sometimes think of that as a God of the gaps argument, that God's found in the gaps, right? The things that we don't understand. And the real challenge is that if sort of one's religious beliefs are anchored in that idea, then what happens as the gaps go away? Right, as science starts to sort of fill in our understanding. And so for some of us, where religion might be an important part of how we operate, that's an important part of our life, it's an important way that we come to know things. If your view is anchored in the God of the gaps, right, and the gaps go away, it sort of leaves you empty in a religious sense. Whereas science, right, tries to sort of fill these gaps and can, in fact, maybe enhance the way you think about religion or a creator. So,
anyone else want to say anything? Okay, the next one will be Dr. Paul Bybee. I'm sure that Dr. Bybee doesn't need any introduction at all. Dr. BYU. He actually got his doctorate degree at BYU when Dr. Jeffrey and I were up there, and it was a long, hard battle, but we finally booted him out the door. We're glad to have him here at UVU. This is Dr. Paul Bybee.
We got him out of jail just for this.
All right. Happy to be out of jail.
Paul, let me read your question. I keep forgetting.
Okay.
Fossils are found in sedimentary deposits throughout the earth. There are those who argue that these could be the remnants of organisms who lived on past planets and whose fragments coalesced to make the Earth, so that the history of life on Earth simply appears to be very old, when in fact it is not. Does that sound familiar to anyone? Is there any evidence to support this hypothesis? And also, how old is the Earth and life on it? And how can we be certain that these ages that these geologists and biologists throw at us are really accurate? Okay, Paul, sorry.
Okay, no problem. Well, as a paleontologist, I can tell you that we deal with these problems all of the time. We can look at these sources of evidence, and they're really good sources of evidence, as one of the aspects of why evolution is a good fact. So we look at absolute and relative dating. Absolute and relative dating have to deal with the stratigraphy of the Earth, and sometimes we have clocks in the rocks that we can call absolute dating as far as the radiometric dating that correspond nicely all over the planet at the same time in the same sediments. If we go to the Grand Canyon, we go up to the top of the Grand Canyon, and there is the Coconino formation up there about 200 million years ago, and we can go right to the bottom of 1.8 billion years of age in a good sequence of undisturbed layers. And we can correlate those layers all over the planet. Not only that, we can look at the fossils, and the fossils are the same in each one of the types of layers that we find all over the planet. For example, we have certain types of trilobites that are found in the Grand Canyon, and they're also found over in Europe, they're found down in Australia, and they all correlate nicely with one another and tell us about the environments that existed where these were at. So not only can we see a sequencing of things going from very simplified to more complex in the geological record, but then we can correlate also with the radiometric dating that occurs in all of the rocks. The oldest rocks that we find are down in Australia at about 4.6 billion years of age. Those are zircon crystals. Well, not only can we correlate with the rocks all over the planet, but then we get meteorites in that show that we have planets that have been broken up between Mars and Jupiter that are also around 4.5 billion years of age. We go to the highlands of the moon, and we can see that we have rocks from there that are 4.4 to 4.5 billion years of age. So we have all of these independent sources of data to help us understand the age of the Earth and of the solar system and what's going on as far as the sediments. They are a continuum. If we go up here to Dinosaur National Monument and look at the dinosaurs there and the sediments that are there, we can go over to Africa and find the same types of sediments in the Tengaroo area with the same types of dinosaurs. So not only can we see plate tectonics working, and plate tectonics is the unifying theory of geology along with evolution, which is the unifying theory, coming together to show you a full picture of how the Earth came about as far as its life and its basic geology. Geology allows life to exist. And so a lot of these types of ideas are reinforced then evolutionarily from the fossil record, from the continuing fossil record all over the planet, plus those same sediments at the same times, layers above and below those same ones that we have absolute dates for. And then the radiometric dating is very, very good as far as correlating what we need as far as clocks in the rocks. So I addressed everything there. I believe I have. And then there were dinosaurs.
Dino what? Okay, our next question will go to Dr. Jerry Johnson from BYU. His research specialty is in fisheries evolution. He's an associate curator of fish at the Bee Museum up there. We've had some interesting times going around our state. Some other states, interesting interaction with people. And Dr. Johnson's question is this: it is not unusual for opponents of evolution to argue that scientists have never observed one species changing into another, or the birth of a new species. Is this a valid argument? Jerry?
Okay. So this is a really interesting question, because it's interesting for a few reasons. You have to ask what motivates this. And for many, there's this view, and it's sort of an old argument, that only organisms can sort of reproduce within their own kind, that there are sort of solid lines between different groups of species, if you will, and that changing from one species to another presents a real challenge. So it's interesting to think about how we viewed this question a while ago and how we think about it now. It's true that speciation can be a slow process, how we can go from one form to another, depending on the mechanism. But there's some really interesting recent work that demonstrates that speciation can occur very rapidly, especially if it's driven by natural selection or by ecological pressures. So we have lots of data that suggest speciation has probably occurred in the past, but we haven't seen it. But more recent work shows that even within ecological timescales over periods of years, we can see new species forming. So there's some fun examples. When we think about what delineates species boundaries, really what we're looking at is evidence for reproductive isolation among groups that have diverged from one another. And so, for example, even in our own lab, we've shown that fishes that coexist with predators and are under strong natural selection to respond to those predators, when compared to populations of the same species of fish with no predators, will show different preferences for individuals that they want to mate with, right? So they have a reproductive isolating boundary based on the presence or absence of predators. And this has occurred over very short time scales. Work in Trinidad on fish, for example, artificial introduction experiments where fish from predator environments were moved to non-predator environments and vice versa. Populations over a period of just about 10 to 15 years are now completely reproductively isolated. They prefer not to mate with individuals that are in the different selective environments. And that's just one example of this. I suspect if I pass the microphone around the panel, right, we'd find lots of contemporary examples where we've actually watched speciation occur. So, anybody else have a favorite they like to weigh in here?
For example, the origin and development of antibiotic-resistant bacteria. Even though the mode of selection is artificial, it's antibiotics, medicine. That's, I think, a wonderful example because bacteria have such shorter generational lifespans. They evolve faster than sort of old phony organisms like us who can age for decades. We've created brand new species, indirectly, unintentionally. But of course, any time that you go to Walgreens, for instance, and get amoxicillin, you know, that's or not amoxicillin, that's a bad example, but methicillin, thank you. You know, that's the reason why amoxicillin no longer works, and you need methicillin, is because of the evolution of organisms, these microorganisms. So we see it.
Do one other quick example of bacteria. Prior to the invention of nylon, bacteria had never been exposed to the byproducts of nylon, and then in a pond outside of a factory in Japan, they noticed these mats of bacteria that were growing. And what had happened is a mutation had occurred in a bacteria that changed one of its enzymes to be able to now break down these byproducts of nylon. So it never existed before. Now all of a sudden you have a bacteria that can break this down, a new species of bacteria, if you will, created because of a new product that was synthesized only 50 years ago.
Just one other quick example has been in the news the last couple of weeks. There's a new strain of bacteria that is resistant to all known antibiotics. And this is the bacteria that causes whooping cough. So folks who don't want to vaccinate their kids against whooping cough, we hope that never gets here to Utah. It hasn't been widespread yet, but this new species has developed that's resistant to all known strains of all different types of antibiotics.
Can I just take a quickie on that? I know we're running out of time. The first species we saw occur in the wild was in Kew Gardens in England back in the 1920s. We also saw new species of tobacco develop in the 1920s here in America.
new habitats can open up opportunities for things to develop new species. We have a species of mosquito that lives only in the subways of London. It lives on the blood of rats and humans. It's related to the ones that live on the surface, but it does not breed with those on the surface. It's a new species of an insect that has developed in a period of time. Here in Utah, we opened up I-80 that runs across the salt flats out there in December of 1969. Within about 4 years, we had a new species of Atroplex, a little salt bush growing out there, Atroplex robusta. So speciation can occur in a hurry, and yes, we've seen them happen. We've made them. So let's go from there.
So I'll just say one more thing. Sorry.
This is a good area, you might notice.
What's really cool about this is that as we've come to think about speciation, the mechanisms really matter here. So some species take a long time to diverge from one another because the mechanism is one of random accumulation of new mutations when they're isolated from one another. Other species evolve very rapidly because of strong selective pressures, where we've pushed divergent populations in different ways. Some species of plants, for example, can occur instantaneously by duplicating their genome and then selfing and then not being able to breed with the source population, the parental plants. And so not only do we have good evidence for rapid speciation, but we're learning a lot about the mechanisms by which some species occur rapidly and others occur more slowly. So it's really kind of a cool area of work that's going on right now.
Okay, the next question is for Dr. Hagen Klaus here at UVU. Dr. Klaus is a member of the anthropology department. What's the name of it?
Behavioral science.
Behavioral science, thank you. He's an anthropologist in behavioral science. And biology, we've got him an office in the biology part, so he's over there with us a lot. And the question for Dr. Klaus is, some people are content with the idea of evolution, but draw the line with humans. Is there compelling evidence of our own evolution when compared to the evidence for other species?
Thank you, Rich. Well, I have to say that drawing the line of evolution with humans is probably a pretty disingenuous argument because over the last 120 years of studies of fossils and over the last 20 years of the study of paleomolecules, literally ancient DNA, what's amassed in the story and the reconstruction of human origins truly is perhaps some of the best evidence of both macroevolution taking place over long periods of time and the origins of many new species of human ancestors and even side branches, but also extraordinary evidence of human microevolution that is taking place in the recent past and also that's currently ongoing right now. The fossil evidence itself, which I teach a couple classes here, and I could go on and on and on about the fossil evidence for this, but I think I've only got about 5 minutes, right? But the fossil evidence itself that has emerged over the last 120 years of excavations throughout much of Africa and parts of Asia is compelling. And by saying that it's compelling, it's put together an understanding. And of course, a critical understanding. When we test hypotheses, remember, what we're trying to do is falsify our hypotheses. We're trying to negate the evidence that we have. And what eventually emerges with the study of the forms, the locations, the times, the anatomy of these fossils is what I would argue and call a beautiful, beautiful, compelling picture of human origins over the last 8 million years. Now, the fossil morphology itself is fantastic, but what's coming of age now are molecular studies. So we've been able to develop new technologies, not just studying the molecular variation of, let's say, the people in this room, but also being able to do things that, you know, 10 years ago we would have thought would be like science fiction, being able to recover what was once thought completely unrecoverable and destroyed DNA from fossils themselves. And what turns out is that the molecular evidence for human evolution, especially over the long term, the human origin sorts of questions,
is of extraordinary correspondence to what we are seeing in the fossil record itself. Literally, it is a record of human origins that is present in every single cell in your body, whether you want it to be or not. So over the long term, the origins of bipedalism, the origins of expansion of the brain, this is again a very, very compelling picture that we understand. But there's also an aspect of human microevolution that exists. We have been able to observe evolution among modern humans, and also the sort of record that's also encoded in our genes and in our cells, in our DNA. So, for example, sickle cell anemia as a response to the selective pressure of malaria, or the evolution of lactose tolerance. Typically, normally, human beings are lactose intolerant after childhood. The distribution and the meaning and the significance of human blood group variation. Skin tone, which is an adaptive feature of all human groups. It's not a racial trait, it's an adaptive trait. And we have a pretty good understanding of exactly what's going on there. The form of your body, your limb proportions, also an evolutionary feature. The migrational history of human beings, both inside and then outside of Africa, has come to be understood. So really what we have, to say the least, is that for human evolution, the standard of proof, I would say, it has to be extremely high, and it is. It may be one of the most high standards of proof, most high bars that exist. And what we have is, through the multidisciplinary study of these types of questions, are many different multiple and independent lines of evidence based on completely different biological phenomena, for instance, that tell basically the same story. They seem to be telling the same story because it is reflecting what is and what has happened. So in general, the evidence for human evolution is extraordinary. And of course, there are those who have the arguments that say that there's very limited data, the fossil record is extraordinarily incomplete with only a very few specimens, that there are so-called missing links. Those are falsehoods. Those are incorrect things to say. So yes.
Well said.
I know I'm evolving. I'm getting bigger and bigger.
join the club. Yeah.
Greater and greater. Okay, one more question. This is for Dr. Heath Ogden, who's a member of our biology department here. He's an evolutionary biologist and entomologist. He's done some really interesting research with these students dealing with evolution. He'll tell us a little bit about that. This is his question. Daniel Dennett wrote a book titled, quote, "Darwin's Dangerous Idea," end quote. Isn't it true that learning evolution is dangerous because it leads to disrespect for the uniqueness of human beings and to social ills that will plague human society, such as social Darwinism?
That's a yes or no question. That's easy. No. Right? First of all, I think sometimes we get confused when we equate Darwinism to the theory of evolution. Although most of, and those that have been my students, know that I give all praise to Darwin for what he did, but we have learned a lot about evolution since Darwin. I mean, multiple mechanisms and the mechanisms of speciation that we're now learning about, all of this, we've actually learned a lot, so I don't like the idea of equating Darwinism to evolution. That some people may have taken ideas that Darwin once talked about and taken them in directions that I don't agree with is a separate issue. So I don't think that inherently evolution is evil. No, it's not. It's a body of science that we learn. It's like saying, is gravity evil? No. Right? I mean, unless you fall really hard, I guess. Right? So I don't agree with that. And what I've seen is that the misconceptions that we have about evolution and the idea that these apparent, that this misconception that we have somehow is going to be in conflict with my particular worldview, religious position or whatever, I just think that's not the right argument. In fact, the evidence that I've been collecting over the last couple semesters here at UVU clearly shows that the more knowledge that people have about evolution, the less conflict and the more harmony they see in their worldview. I've got really strong evidence for this. And so what this means is, you know, parents don't need to be
worried that their students are going to a university and going to learn the godless art of evolution. Okay, that's just not the true story. In fact, the more that students learn about evolution, the better, more well-rounded worldview they have, and that's been shown in the evidence that I've been collecting. And so, you know, I'm all about, I think that we ought to be teaching evolution better. We ought to be doing it better. We ought to be starting earlier. And that's why, you know, a lot of these guys have been involved in going into the high schools and even into elementary schools, I think, in some cases. I think that's really the way that we need to go. And that will allow people to understand that there's not this discrepancy. Evolution isn't evil, and it doesn't plague human society with these bad ideas.
You want that?
Yeah, just to go back to the original question, it was a wonderful answer.
But to go back
to the original question, it reminds me of something that Stephen Jay Gould once said, which is that with the increasing knowledge of human evolution, and where this brings us to is an understanding of our absolutely common humanity that unites us all. And that's not a science. That's not a politically correct argument to make everybody feel better about themselves. It's an argument that is scientifically absolutely correct. Mm-hmm. The fact that everyone in this room shares the same genes and the same sequence in 99.998% commonality with any other living human being who's alive today or who has been alive for the last 100,000 years. So it's a remarkable understanding that unites us. It does not divide us. And when things like social Darwinism emerge, or as they have in the past, that needs to be understood as a perversion of science.
Well said.
Anyone else? Okay, just one quick statement I'd like to make to you. In fall of 2005, our famous or infamous Senator Chris Butters tried to get intelligent design put into the schools of Utah. The intelligent design people told him you can't use God. You can't use that word God, as Dr. Jeffers already explained. So he changed the name of it from intelligent design to divine design. And what's frightening is that nearly passed through our legislature to include that in all of our science classes in the state. Dr. Jeffers played a key role. He debated Senator Butters. I guess you could call it a debating. Dr. Jeffers is the only one that had any facts. But, there is no controversy with science or religion. I'll just say that in conclusion. And people who try to twist it so that it is are doing themselves and the people that they know a great disservice. If you would like to read a masterpiece of a legal decision, go to Google, type in Kitzmiller, that's Kitzmiller, Kitzmiller versus Dover, Pennsylvania. Judge John Jones was here several years ago. It was his decision that teaching intelligent design in science classroom is unconstitutional, period. It's only 139 pages, but the last eight are a summary if you don't have a lot of time. Okay, let's take questions from the...
Let's do the following. It's 1:45. A lot of you have other classes. Why don't we, those of you who need to leave, go ahead and leave right now. And those of you who want to hang around and ask questions and chat, please do so. That way we'll...
If you're going to stay and ask questions, move up to the front, that we can put away these microphones.
I was about to say, you're sitting here.
Supernatural phenomenon, right? Fall out of the bounds of science. We just can't work with that stuff. And so, you know, do some people say, all right, the theory of evolution, here's a body of scientific work, given these data, given this evidence, it must tell us something about supernatural things, right? Like, it must tell us that God doesn't exist, because here we have this natural mechanism for how the diversity of life came about on the earth, right? But if we're genuine about these things, right, we'll say, look, science has our bounds. Right? We don't step into areas that go beyond the natural world. So some would advocate and say, science must lead us to be atheists, right? Must lead to that conclusion. Others would say, oh, these results from science really, in my mind, confirm the existence of God or the existence of some supernatural power. Either of those outcomes might be true, right? Could be true. One of them is probably true. But the point is that if we're honest as scientists, right, we'll say, look, this is the box we operate in, and it's a great box. In fact, many, many advances, good things that have come to humanity, discoveries that we've made, have come because we've stuck to these rules of science. Okay? Are there other ways of knowing things? Yeah, absolutely, right? You can use logic as a way to think through and come to know things, right? Many people feel like that we can use spiritual direction as a way to come to know things in our lives. But science is very specific in what we do and what we don't do. And that sort of keeps us in a neutral zone to some in some respects, you know, in terms of what values we associate with scientific outcomes, right? Science doesn't sort of hold values up in that way that might be dangerous or faith-building or not faith-building, those types of things.
Okay, are there any questions? Would you please stand and tell us your name and address it to one of the panel in particular, if you would please.
Yeah. This is for any of you. I was wondering, what is your favorite example of something that was once considered irreducibly complex, but now we have a pretty good idea of how that trait might evolve?
So the question was, what's a good example of something that in the past was irreducibly complex in sort of the scientific realm and isn't any longer? I'll give you sort of a general example, and then I'm sure other people have specifics. We used to have a really hard time understanding the Cambrian explosion, for example, where in a short period of evolutionary time, you had the evolution of many different animal phyla. Well, now that we have a much better understanding of how developmental genes act on the expression of traits, we understand that really small mutations or single or few mutations in a developmental gene can result in a really different body plan or really major changes in a lineage. And so it's actually it's kind of expected that you would get these big changes in a short period of time because of changes in developmental genes. So I could probably pass this on to more specifics. Yeah.
The Cambrian radiation she's talking about was 20 million years, so it's not an explosion like a lot of people like to think. It is an actual radiation. In that time, the Hox genes and all of the genes that Dr. Stephen was talking about were built up and developed and selected for. So there was an incredible amount of selection and competition. Great numbers of animals were being developed. Over 100 phyla were being developed at this time, down to 36 phyla that we have today. And you can tell just by that great huge discrepancy there that there was a lot of things going on, everybody eating everybody else. But still, these things we're talking about millions of years again. So it's nice to see how the molecular stuff that a lot of people on the panel here utilize, along with the fossil record, they correlate with one another and strengthen one another. They don't disagree with one another.
I might say just quickly that the human eye was always held up as the classic example. Even Darwin said, just looking at it gives me the cold shudders. I couldn't quite figure it out a while ago. Nobody would use the human eye these days to argue against evolution. You'll get nailed so fast. The bacterial flagellum has been the popular one of intelligent design. That one, too, they could not defend in court with Judge Jones. The immune system of humans is kind of the current one. And that's about where they go. But there's, I don't know, any good one these days that really will hold up.
Anybody else? Yeah, and just real quickly, maybe to the other panelists as well. I've got a real problem with the concept of irreducible complexity, because that's a term and a concept that comes from outside of science. I don't think there's anything that we see in the natural world that when we approach it, we would consider it to be irreducibly complex. We start to try to understand it. We try to unpack it develop a rational scientific understanding from it. So I don't think that's the point of view that we ever start from as scientists.
We anticipate complexity.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yep. That's how the world works.
Yeah. Yeah. Good question.
Yeah, this is for everybody. But so some people, because of their religious background, like the people in their religion, they have authority figures that say that it's you shouldn't go and research anything that's counter to the religion itself. It's a slippery slope or something like that. What in what regards, how would you delicately place that in the sense of explaining that it's not so much of a counter-argument, even though those authority figures directly say things like evolution is a counter-argument to the religion itself?
Delicately?
Academic cowards.
Again, I can't speak for every religion on the planet here, right? But what I find is that most religions, for most students, they don't understand what their official doctrine of their religion is. So they're starting already with a supposition that is incorrect. Now, if someone did belong to a religion that was, you know, inherently against, you know, old earth, you know, any type of evolutionary change or something, well, that's the type of thing. I used to be a creationist. I was. When I started my scientific career, I didn't think that Earth was old, and I didn't think organisms evolved. I didn't think there was any death before Adam and Eve. But once the evidence that I was looking at and the patterns, and I started to look at things, I had to change my worldview. Fortunately, I didn't have to change my entire faith, but that may have to be the case, and sometimes that may be a tough decision for people. Okay? But I think mostly, if people will examine what their faith really says, it's not inherently against examining things in science. Most religions accept that which is demonstrated in science.
That explains a lot about you, Heath.
I know.
If you want to send me an email, rtolman@uvu.edu, I have a PowerPoint that has quotes from the Catholic Church, the Presbyterian Church, and the Methodist Church, indicating that there they have no conflict, no problems with the theory of evolution.
Real quick addition to that. So I think a good dose of humility, both as a scientist and maybe as sort of a believer, are a good way to approach things. The awesome thing about science is that a lot of times we think we've got it figured out, right? But paradigms shift all the time. And that's an exciting thing about science, right? Like, I'd love to be the guy that could roll in and say, hey, I've got an alternative explanation to the theory of evolution that explains the diversity of life on Earth, right? And here's how it works, and it's testable, and, right? I'd be a famous guy if I could pull that one off. But sometimes things like that happen. We discover new things, we think about things differently. So scientists have to be humble. We have to realize that we don't have it all figured out. And the neat thing about science is that we never prove anything. We only disprove ideas that are inconsistent with the data. And what we're left with is our theory, right? Our best guess about how it works. And, you know, in religion, sometimes we think we've got it all figured out too, don't we? Right? We think we know what the answers are, and those things sometimes, you know, need some humility as well in terms of what we understand and maybe what we don't understand. Most faiths, and certainly scientists, are seeking truth. We just want to know how things work. And I think in many cases, these truths can come together in a nice way, right? If you're sort of open to thinking about how they come together. Sometimes they don't, right? Sometimes there's this cognitive dissonance where you have to sort of simultaneously hold two ideas, two truths that seem really pretty apparent to you, right? But I found in my own life that if I'm patient, right, if I wait on it, a lot of times I can get some insights into how things come together that maybe early on didn't quite work for me. So, things to think about.
Here's one other quick example of a paradigm shift. Joseph Priestley, back in the 17th century, was given credit for discovering oxygen. Joseph Priestley never used the word oxygen. That came from a guy over in France across the channel that didn't know what he was talking about, some guy named Lavoisier. Priestley called the air that he had isolated dephlogisticated air. He knew how to remove the phlogiston from the air, and he never used the term oxygen. But that paradigm has shifted. So at least Jerry said these paradigm shifts will continue in science. We don't know where they'll come from, but it's just the way science works.
Yeah, of course.
I used to use a text in my philosophy of biology class at BYU that had a sentence in that generated more discussion than anything else in the whole class. The statement said, all belief systems tend to close the mind. And my kids at BYU didn't like to think they had closed minds. And this generated great discussion, and it's pretty well showed that some of them did have pretty closed minds. And that is true for any other belief system, I think, human name. So we have to be very careful what we're doing with that one. And Heath's point about different religions have different points of view than people think. My son-in-law taught for a while in Nebraska, and he would send his kids out to ask their rabbi, their imam, their bishop, their whoever else, what does my church teach about evolution? And they came back saying, I had no idea, it was so open. A little booklet that one might like to look at is one called Voices for Evolution. Third edition was edited by Carrie Sager, S-A-G-E-R, and I'll be happy to. It's from the National Center for Science Ed. It has 100 and some odd statements from educational, science professional, and religious organizations about the compatibility of evolution with their points of view.
You have a question right here, and then Dr. Matthews.
Okay, so do you think that a lot of the comforts or preventatious things that we do in society today, do you think that is actually weakening our evolutionary growth as humans? Does that make sense?
Is it dysgenic? Yes.
Yeah, does that make sense?
Yes.
You said yes.
I think the basic question was, is modern medicine and modern technology and so on dysgenic?
Yes.
Are we degenerating the quality of the human gene pool? Is that what we're getting?
Or just like stopping our evolutionary progression.
Okay, two separate questions. What's going on with our current evolutionary progression? And yes, we are still evolving.
Right.
Dr. Hagen, Dr. Klassen can mention a good deal of those, but the lactose tolerance is a good one. Ordinarily, mammals can digest lactose until they leave nursing from their mothers, and then they turn off the gene for lactase. But apparently about 8,000 years ago, when perhaps dairying became a little more important in Northern Europe, we began to select perpetual lactose, like lactase. I can't get my words straight here today. But we did not turn off the gene for lactase, so that adults now could utilize this new food source, which would ordinarily have given them a lot of troubles, indigestion and so on. That's only one. We're losing our teeth, for instance, our wisdom teeth. Don't Twinkies help that, don't forget the Twinkies. But yes, we are changing still, but we are also permitting the reproduction of people who would not have reproduced 50 or 100 years ago. A classic case of that has to do with pyloric stenosis. Many babies born with the inability to open the sphincter that lets food from the stomach into the intestine. We used to have a very low percentage of that, but we learned that we could cut that sphincter and make it so that they were perfectly happy from there on, perfectly healthy. We have far more cases of pyloric stenosis born today than we ever did in the past, because we are indeed permitting the perpetuation of those genes. So yes, we're evolving in some ways. We're, if you want to say, devolving in others. Could we ultimately see a genetic twilight for the human species? I really don't know. We started this with Theodosius Lobshansky, and he addressed that question. He said, for instance, will we face a genetic twilight if we do not let these people reproduce? If we take away the right to reproduce, we will certainly face the certainty of a moral twilight. So we have to continue with the best medicine we have. We'll leave it there.
Bill?
I'm Phil Matheson from UDU. My question is something that I've had fun with, I guess, in a sense, with my family and friends who have problems with evolution. And I've posited to them the question, what would happen if evolution weren't true? What would be removed from our society, our medicine, our biology understanding? Could you comment on that? If evolution weren't true, what would be removed from us?
All right, go for it. Go for it, kiddo.
Your very existence.
Who wants to address that?
I'll take
your act. Oh, yeah. Everybody.
I mean, essentially,
we all kind of want to let each other.
We're where we are because of the dawn of agriculture when we started to do our own. Dawn of agriculture, right? We wouldn't be where we are now without evolutionary principles. So. The food that we eat, right? The crops that we grow, that's all a product of selection mushrooms, right? We started doing it evolution a long, long time ago. We started manipulating the process of evolution 10, 20,000 years ago, and we're still benefiting from that. So think now where that's brought us, and think now about how crippled our students would be competing in a global market where technologies that drive medicine and pharmacology, human health issues, agriculture, biotechnology, technology, those are all driven by fundamental principles of evolutionary biology. And so from an educational background, that's why we are so vested in this, right? Because we don't want to send out handicapped students into this workforce. Right? We want them empowered with these tools to be able to make these types of breakthroughs. They really need a fundamental understanding of evolution and evolution and biology and how these principles work. And further, we feel like the whole idea of evolution, particularly evolution by natural selection, is a fundamental way of looking at our world, looking at who we are, where we came from, and how we solve problems. And so that's another reason why I think that it's really, really important that folks understand evolutionary biology and principles of evolution, because without them, we likely would not have made it off the savannah in many ways, right? We would not be where we are today.
All right. I think it's really important to remember that every one of the classes that we have here in biology has an evolutionary basis. All the way from microbiology, going up to developmental biology, and all of these have an evolutionary aspect to them. Everything, especially microbiology. Right, Dr. Kersey? Viruses, excuse me. Yes, sir.
Anatomy.
All right. So, you know, everything that we do has evolution in it. Everything.
The guy in the purple shirt there, and then we'll work our way forward here.
I was reading a decent amount about competition with evolution. And I was wondering if you guys could address, you know, whoever wants to address it, whether evolution is more like weeding out the weakest or more about survival of the strongest. I understand survival of the strongest came from social Darwinism. It wasn't necessarily Darwin itself, but I was wondering if you guys could address that.
I don't believe survival of the fittest is true, but I believe survival of the fitter is true. Adaptation is the whole key here, but everybody can talk on that, right? Go ahead.
Something that I like to tell my students, and I say that this is nothing to emulate in this respect, but evolution is often the survival of those who are mediocre. In some ways, that what we're talking about here is that for selection to take place, selection against or selection for, well, technically it's only selection against, but you'd have to be just good enough in terms of the suite of advantageous traits that you may possess. You don't have to be excellent about it, but you have to have it, you know, just good enough so that you do have just maybe a little bit more selective fitness versus another individual.
I just wanted to say it's not all selection too. There's mutations, genetic gene flow, migration. There are a bunch of mechanisms that cause evolution. It's not just survival of the fittest. There are a bunch of it. And the more that we learn about molecular evolution, the more we see how powerful neutral theory and the way in which mutation and genetic drift work
are very powerful forces in evolution. So it's not just that, it's not just that.
So I use the phrase survival of good enough a lot, or another way to put it, survival of the not suckiest. But the conditions are always changing. So what's good enough now isn't necessarily good enough later. And there's a second part to that. Not only do you have to survive long enough to get to adulthood, you have to find a mate to pass on your genetic information to the next generation. So you have a moving target, and you have multiple conditions throughout your lifetime. So at each step of the way, you get this sort of filtering of the worst or the unluckiest, right? Like Heath just said, it's not always about selection. Sometimes it's just chance. And then, you know, so it's a passing on mediocrity to your descendants.
And so maybe just implicit in this question, we often think about, when we talk about fittest, right, or strongest, we sometimes assume that, like, bigger, stronger, better, right, that those are all traits that are going to be the best in terms of surviving and reproducing. But there are lots of examples, right, where small, sneaky, right, but we wouldn't associate with this sort of being the kind of physically strong or tough, strong sorts of traits, end up having higher fitness. Like, one of the examples I really love adding to this idea of finding a mate, did you know, like, bluegill sunfish?
That there never could be selection for cooperative behaviors, right, or altruistic type behaviors. And that is not the case anymore. So there were initially models that showed how this could happen, and then scientists went out into the wild and found mating systems and social systems that were appropriate to test these ideas, and are accumulating tremendous, really convincing data to show that this is not the case, that there are lots of opportunities, lots of situations in which cooperation is under very, very strong selection and can be selected for in these populations. And that, you know, going against the grain, or that competition is not the best way to achieve success, reproductive success types of situations.
That obviously hit a little bit of a nerve. Go ahead.
A couple of quick questions. One, I'd like Dr. Jeffries to let us know what the official Mormon stance is on evolution. And then for the panel, we've talked a lot about the attack of religion on science. Could you talk about the pushback of science on religion in the recent decades?
Could you repeat the last half of that after the Mormon part?
Well, just what the Mormon's official stance is on evolution, the Mormon Church. And then, like the panel, talk about the pushback of science against religion.
Okay, the LDS Church operates on a system that permits a good deal of speculation on a lot of things. Only official statements from the First Presidency constitute the formal doctrine of the Church. You don't find that in manuals, you don't find that in, you know, other sorts of stuff. It's official statements from the First Presidency. C-Y, three of them. Their first address to evolution was in 1909. It's a little bit anti-evolutionary feeling. It says that Adam took upon himself an appropriate body and doesn't say anything else. People wrote in and said, you know, look, we've been speculating. Mormonism had all sorts of ideas about where Adam came from. Where did he come from? And so in April 1910, the First Presidency, in their official columns in the Improvement Era, the official magazine, published a short statement that is the most explicit and the last real addressment of that question by a First Presidency. They point out that creating Adam from the dust of the ground and so on, that's the scripture, but they say the scriptures don't tell us how this is done. Then they give you three options. One, whether humans evolved through natural processes under the direction and power of God, whether they were transplanted from another planet, whether they were born here in mortality as other mortals have been, are questions not fully answered and revealed the Word of God. That's where it left. That's where God left. Now, there have been other statements since. In 1925, with the Scopes trial, the First Presidency released a formal statement, Mormon view of evolution in the Improvement Era. That that really is just a shortened version of the 1909 one. It says Adam took upon himself an appropriate body, took out all the anti-evolution sentiment from 1909, and left it really as an incredibly open statement for all the religions from 1925. If you compare them with others, it's really quite open. That has never changed since. We did get into a major theological debate in 1931. B.H. Roberts, who was the primary apologist of the church in those years, had written a big book wherein he was arguing that life and death have been going on this planet for millions of years before the time of Adam, as it was usually thought in Scripture, and that there were indeed pre-Adamites, individuals preceding the time of Adam that were human-like beings on this planet. Joseph Fielding Smith was arguing with that. This went on for some time, and eventually in April 7th of 1931, all the general authorities were called together at a meeting. And the First Presidency ruled that we take no stance on whether there was death before the fall of Adam or whether there were pre-Adamites here on the earth. Leave it alone. And if you look at the Encyclopedia of Mormonism that was published in 1992, and the First Presidency at that time approved and indeed in some ways authored the statement on evolution. It quotes the 1931 memo and says, leave science to the scientists, basically, while we magnify our calling in the realm of the church, in the realm of the church, and you know, leave the subject alone. That's really the official stance. We have people get a little upset at BYU periodically who write into our dean or write to the chair or et cetera, biology chair or to the president of the university, and you don't want to have somebody's head because they're teaching evolution. The favorite response from some of our administrators has just been to write back to these people and say, why don't you take that up with President Monson? He knows what we're doing here, you tell him about it. And that's the end of that story. So that's about where we are. The manuals are still teaching a scriptural point of view, and I think there's some critical reasons for that because of the incredible missionary type thing going on. I helped write Aaronic priesthood manuals a number of years ago, and we were told your standard is you write a manual so that a convert of 3 weeks can pick it up and teach the lesson. We had some long discussion about that, but that was the standard, and I think it still is.
Does that help a bit?
Now, the pushback of science against religion. There have been the so-called modern atheists that have wanted to use evolution and science for their crusade against religion. That will be such people as Daniel Dennett and Richard Dawkins, Sam Harris, Christopher Francis, and so on. But they are using science for their point of view just as well as other people are trying to use it for theirs. I said it's not inherent in the science to do that. That applies to the aggressive atheists as well as to the aggressive theists. It's not inherent in the science.
Okay, question back here.
So I think it's kind of interesting that, you know, for over 100 years we've even been having this debate since the evidence was laid out fairly well in the beginning, and it's just kind of been collaborated ever since then. So my question is kind of two parts. What do you think the major opponent of evolution just being understood in our country? Other countries seem to be ahead of us on this, but in our country, is it our media? Is it religious interpretation? Is it cultural? Is it a lack of education? And what can we do to prevent that and to go forward with it so that it is the well understood and the baseline?
The easy answer to your first part is yes, but Dr. Ogden here has more to elaborate on.
I don't want to get into all of the other social things that might be. Maybe someone else could comment on that. But I do want to say I don't think we've done a good job at teaching evolution. Now my students, my 10-10 students, know I give a lot. I mean, I do almost half of the semester is evolution. And again, in this research I've been doing, I've been able to basically get from about a 35% acceptance of evolution, including human evolution, at the beginning of the semester, up to about a 75-80% at the end of the semester. So what this means is, if you teach people I don't know, I don't want to say well enough, because I'm just learning how to do this business. I'm still learning how to do this. But if we do it, I think if we do teach people well enough, they will see the evidence and they will change their worldviews and they'll be okay. And like I said, I don't think that they have to throw out their religious ideas. I don't think there even has to be a debate. I think this doesn't have to be a debate or a controversy. It's simply you look at evidence. I mean, we don't have a controversy about gravity, right? So I don't see a need for that. So my response is, I think we can do a better job of teaching it. That's what these guys are doing. Dr. Jeffries was my evolution teacher. I mean, I can thank him for kind of me being here, right?
And, I'm sorry, everybody.
I'm so sorry. No, cool. Does anyone else want to say anything?
There's something really basic here, going back beyond evolution. If we really did a good job in the schools, and this is starting to change now, of teaching students in our science classes the nature of science. As Jerry mentioned, what are the rules of science and how does science operate? If they really understood that, then this creationism or intelligent design, it would be very, very clear that it's not science and has no business being in a science classroom.
I'll just say that scientists or students of science carry some of this responsibility, right? So I think we need to make sure that we're not uncomfortable talking with our neighbors and friends about the value of science and what it's done for us, right? How important it is in terms of benefits to our society. I think that's one thing. So academics talk a lot about, do we spend enough time in the public talking about things that we sort of take for granted, and probably not. The other thing that I think that we need to do better as scientists is sort of policing ourselves and making sure that although we may have views that extend beyond the bounds of science, and certainly we do, right? We have social positions on things and religious views and values, the things that are important to us, that we ought not to borrow our science as sort of a tool to promote those views one way or the other, right? I think a lot of people worry about the theory of evolution because there are a handful of prominent evolutionary biologists who are sort of hammering this idea that the science requires that one see the world in an atheistic way, right? And that's unfair, it's inappropriate that science, that we as evolutionary biologists don't do a better job of policing our own and saying, look, you might think that, but that's not what the science says, right? You can't use science to make your point in this regard. So there's some things like that I think that we can do a better job of as well.
Jerry, can I borrow?
Yeah.
It's an interesting thing to me. There's some Stephen Jay Gould was very interested in the notion of why didn't Darwin publish for all of those years after his theory was essentially at least outlined and beginning to be fleshed out. There's some evidence that indicates that he was very worried about social Darwinism, exactly as the question you asked earlier, survival of the fittest, and that he was worried about the fact that could lead to war and to genocide and to such things as we saw in the last century and are seeing around us now. I was in a